more time is not
the best match I've ever seen.
Only because I'm coming over.
My write-up of that last crime was so ingenious that Purlock Publishing tossed me quite a tidy sum. I believe this next one will do.
I wonder if someone could tell me more about this.
I'm just the housekeeper, but Mr. Casham was a dear friend. Each morning I bring him his coffee. Today his door was locked shut. My husband is the caretaker. We live downstairs. We have the keys to all the apartments, so after knocking, I became concerned and let myself in and found him like this. The lights weren't working. My husband didn't want to waste any candles, so we retired early.
Thank you.
I believe I should reinterrogate a suspect.
Gone just like that, eh? He lived right next door and often came home from his concerts a bit drunk and singing at the top of his lungs. Drove my wife near crazy. Cashin had an eye for the ladies, no question. I was a bit jealous of him, frankly. I was down in the cellar, fiddling with my experiments. That belongs to Mr. Golden. He's an awfully nice chap. We let him use our apartment during the day when my wife and I are out tending our shop. He likes to rehearse here, where the light's better. I'm an amateur chemist. Henman let me set up a few experiments in the cellar.
Mr. Cashin is dead? I just saw him yesterday. He looked in the peak of health. If you ask me, he paid a bit too much attention to the caretaker's wife. Scandalous, really. They must have seen each other nearly every day. When the lights quit working yesterday, that sweet Mr. Golden handed out candles to everyone. He's such a nice man. Last night I was knitting in that chair. Then I felt quite sickly and opened the window to clear my head. I certainly didn't hear anything.
It's true. I loved him. He was the best thing that ever happened to me.
I wonder if someone could tell me more about this.
Mr. Cashin was a respected music critic, a very accomplished man.
Well now, I didn't ask about this.
Thank you. I work very late. So did he. I only met him once or twice in the 2 years I've been living here. I use him to create an ambience when I hold private recitals. I was out giving a benefit recital for unemployed musicians. Several dozen people can attest to my whereabouts.
I should return and find out about this. I believe I should reinterrogate a suspect. I should go back and ask about this.
Mr. Cashin's dead. Difficult to believe. He led a quiet life. Out at concerts most nights, shut up in his room writing the rest of the time. He must have been a lonely man. My wife felt sorry for him and helped him as often as she could. I forgot to put it away after I fixed Mr. Golden's music stand yesterday morning. I left it there, and he came to give it back. The gas quit working yesterday. I don't know enough to fix such things safely myself. A man from the company is going to come by tomorrow. I'm in charge of the running and upkeep of the whole building, so I can get dirty now and then. I was just doing some work in the basement.
Ah, yes, be careful with that. It can be dangerous. It reacts badly with heat. Was down in the cellar, fiddling with my experiments. In any case, why on earth would I want to kill that old sod?
He destroyed an entire orchestra. All those musicians put out of work. A rancorous old man who had no talent or creativity of his own.
I suspect there was more to that mystery than meets the eye. I'm going to look into it.
Up off to the clink with you.
With that four.
Whoa.
read, then no one shall read at all!
Another stiff. Cool, dear.
A weak spot somewhere. Find it. Then we break in and burn everything. If the government won't help people like us to read, then no one shall read at all. Oi!
Let's do this the easy way.
Oi! What do you think you're doing? I'm busy here.
Keep quiet, Mr. Fowler. Hush now.
Oh, let me go, will you?
Apologies, but the sergeant wants a word.
Trouble is brewing.
It's about burning down print houses, I know. It was a terrible idea.
I've got
I should never have done
you.
It, but I'm just so angry. I'm so angry, and I want everyone to feel as angry as I do.
The world doesn't need more anger in it, Mr. Fowler.
Run then!
There you go. Slowly now.
One less building burned to ashes.
This is it. This is my moment. Now on, everyone will remember Peter needs
Peter the Strong.
Conqueror. Peter the Great. The ancient ruins below will rise. And the old will be new again. I will be as Achilles was. I will be great and powerful, and I will live on forever in the minds of the weak.
anything you need to... Have a good day now.
Thank you. Back again, by all means. That's not to say you both.
Ah! The bed and bottle welcomes all!
Bed and bottle. Once you come, you'll never want to leave.
Oh.
How nice to see you again, Mr. Dickens. Is it time for another of the Ghost Club stories?
As a matter of fact, yes. Follow me. Number 50, Berkeley Square. Four stories high and branded, Beware All Those Who Enter. There have been many strange tales of this dreadful domicile. The earliest report of a haunting was said to be the specter of a small girl who was murdered by a servant. She could be seen at the attic windows, weeping and wringing her little hands in an agony of despair. I'm eager to begin. You're not afraid, are you? Another legend claims the attic is haunted by the spirit of a young woman who purportedly threw herself from the top floor windows to escape her abusive uncle. Her screaming ghost has reportedly been sighted hanging from the window ledge. This residence was briefly owned by a Mr. James Jasper, a choir master and an opera act. His nephew Edward was betrothed to one of Mr. Jasper's pupils, the fair and delicate Rose. However, Edward disappeared under mysterious circumstances, followed by Jasper himself. Perhaps grief sent him back to the soothing arms of his narcotic mistress. Shall we? Though this house is vacant, some say it comes alive at night with screams of terror, ringing bells, and slamming shutters. Although eerie, this phenomenon is easily produced by pneumatic tubes and valves. There are claims that a young man was caged in the attic, his only connection to the rest of the world, a tiny hole in the door. A young man who was reduced to madness by this extreme isolation. The legends all seem to focus on one room in particular. A sudden draft, nothing more. My word, perhaps I shall wait here while you investigate the source of that laughter, which is not at all unsettling. Thank you.
charming. Right. Now tell me, why were you at that house?
I've found a lock, but I haven't located the key.
It's here.
Ha! So this is how it works.
Impressive.
No one. His love for Rosa came near to equaling mine. It should have been enough to keep my beloved nephew away. My poor Ned. Forgive.
I did.
Alas, the myth has been discredited. There was no ghost in Berkeley Square, just a wretched soul driven to murder and madness by guilt and intoxication. I think this has the makings of a rather fine novel. I wonder if I've got one left in me.